Hello, everyone, and welcome to Collider Nightmares. We're live today.
Yeah.
Yay. Oh, boy, we are so nervous.
Oh, boy.
Oh, Nelly.
Oh, gosh.
Oh, I think I'm going to barf.
We'll hang in there, hopefully. Thank you guys so much for joining us. We're really happy to see you. There's so much news to get into today. So let's go ahead and introduce our panel. To my left is Miss Perrin Nemiroff.
Is this thing on? Are we all right? Does everything work the same way? Yes, it does, and we have a great lineup for you. Thank you guys so much if you're watching live. Share the link. Let everybody know we're up and running now.
Yes, what she said. And to her left is Mr. John Schnepp.
That's right, we're doing it live! We're live, baby!
Anything can happen! And to my right is Mr. Mark Riley.
Oh my God, I am so excited to be live for Collider Nightmares. You're going to regret putting it live after Friday the 13th news, okay? Ooh. That's all I'm going to say. Let's do this.
Let's do it. We're going to do it. But before we get into that, we have some breaking news. So the trailer for Wish Upon just dropped. I'm very excited about this. So here's what you need to know about Wish Upon. The movie stars Joey King, Ryan Phillippe, Shannon Purser, a.k.a. Barb from Stranger Things, and Ki-Hong Lee. The movie is a sort of a reunion with Conjuring star Joey King and director John Leonetti, who was James Wan's longtime DP, and Wish Upon hits theaters on June 30th. Guys, I love this trailer. This is a great first look. So Wish Upon is kind of like a takeoff on a genie story gone wrong with a teenage girl who's maybe a little bullied. I'm loving it. What are your reactions?
I really liked this. And you can isolate certain things that happen in this trailer and be like, oh, I've seen something like that before. It's like one of the first scares reminded me a little of what happens in The Craft, you know, when she starts to lose her hair and stuff like that. But something about the whole package of it feels really natural and really right to me. I really like Joey King in this role. It's nice to see such a real young person in this kind of part. And I'm really just excited to see her in a leading role like this too. So I can't wait to see her crush it. And just something about the progression of the trailer, how they just put their high concept out there so nice and neatly, and then I'm going to tease you with all this really creepy stuff. And whatever that little stinger at the end was, I don't know what happened to make that visual happen, but that's how you end a trailer. This thing is great. I can't wait.
Love it, guys.
Yeah, I had to rewind that end part because I'm like, what am I watching right now? Great trailer. Yeah, I love it. I mean, you know, it's a kind of tried and true story about like the monkey hand, like the wishes and like the repercussions of that. And you get this. I love that the music box or the box thing. I love the way it looks. It's very Hellraiser reminiscent for me at least. So I'm in. What a great trailer.
Yeah, I guess we're all in agreement. I love this trailer. It reminded me a little of like Wishmaster meets Kronos with the mechanical device that can somehow warp time to whatever your wishes are. I don't know if there's some kind of creature behind it or not, but I laughed out loud when she got splashed with blood. I just love gore. So it was like one of those things like, that's pretty satisfying. I don't know what happened, but I can't wait to find out. So what a great trailer.
Very excited. Love the body horror, too. Hopefully there will be a lot of that. I don't know if it's going to be a PG-13 or R yet. Right. I'm kind of hoping very selfishly for an R rating, but I think more than likely it's going to probably be PG-13. But we will keep you posted on all of that as we learn that information. So now, let's go ahead and move into our fresh meat.
Fresh. Squishy.
Guys, so we're just going to kick it off with a bang, and here we go. Friday the 13th was removed from Paramount's release schedule. OMG! We're not going to do a big rigmarole. Here's what you need to know. It looks like it's being shut down indefinitely. World War Z 2 was also pulled, but that doesn't seem like as a big of a deal considering this movie was not coming out in 4 months. Could Ring's soft performance at the box office be to blame? Some people are saying that that's what's up. And finally, rights are expected to revert back to New Line. But that I don't think would happen until 2018. So, Riley.
Oh, hi.
Now, Riley, you have been bottling this up, so much up. You gave a little teaser, a little taste on Movie Talk yesterday.
Yeah, that news broke right as I was getting on that panel. So, I had thoughts. Here's the thing. Okay. What the hell is wrong with you, Paramount? Like, why can't you figure out a Friday the 13th movie. It is not hard. I've been saying, how many times have I said this? They keep doing the thing. They go back and they do the origin story. We got to explain away our force of nature. We got to unveil the mask and show you this broken person. No, you don't. You start with the urban legend, the creepy ghost story around the campfire about a kid drowning in the lake, and then that's it. And then you're off and running. I don't understand how it's taken so long to get a Friday 13th movie. I can't believe that they have to redo the origin yet again. The reboot was great. It was. I'm going to say it. It was great. I thought it was a great first step. I was excited for a sequel. But now it's like, I don't understand how you can screw up a Friday the 13th movie. It is really not that hard. You're adding in their father, the mother, the sister, the brother. What else do you have up your... Like, I don't get it. I do not get it. I don't know why you even have to, like, give up the perfect 13th film in the franchise. It's the 13th film in the franchise, and you had October 13th of this year to launch it. I'm actually speechless. I am so absolutely upset because I've been supporting you. I've said, oh, okay, you're casting the father. Let me put a positive spin on it. No, and then you shut it down. I don't get it. I don't get it. Guys, please help me.
Okay,
get it.
Yeah. I mean, it doesn't seem like effing rocket science here, right? I mean, we've talked about this a million times before, and I don't understand why we're trying to assign high concept onto something that is not high concept.
Perfect
Jason
way to say it.
Jason is a killer who kills teenagers who have sex at a camp. That's it. Sean Cunningham, going way back to the beginning, has said as much. Meat and potatoes franchise. Why are they trying to make it? It ain't that serious.
That's the problem, though. It's like we can look at it and say, oh, it's as simple as just doing it right based on what this franchise is from the beginning, what we know and love about this. But at the same time, we're also always saying, oh, how are they going to remake that and make it just a little bit different? You got to put your own stamp on it. You got to make it a little bit special. And this, to me, is a perfect example of someone trying to make a new installment of Friday the 13th special, and it just spiraling out of control. There's something to be said about simplicity when you do things like that. You keep the focus on one thing that makes a ton of sense. You don't just keep adding all this nonsense. And overall, though, with all horror franchises, I really think you are in a much safer position if you steer clear of origin stories.
Yes.
I can't name a single horror franchise installment that has gone back and told the origin story of a slasher or a main villain, and it have worked. I mean, Rings is the perfect example. I don't necessarily know if Paramount said, oh, Rings didn't do as well as we hoped at the box office, so that means Friday the 13th is a guaranteed failure as well, because I don't know which article, Hollywood Reporter or Variety, but they had said that the Paramount reps thought that this was a crossover audience, but it's not really. I mean, yes,
meaning like Rings and Friday the 13th
are going after the same exact people. I will say, yeah, there's genre fans out there, but I do think we're talking about two franchises that appeal to in two areas in some respect. But I don't think Rings in that sense was the major red flag for this. The red flag was the fact that they tried to add information to Samara in Rings, and it blew up in their faces big time, and it would have happened here. And maybe from a script perspective, that's what happened. They re-looked at, you know, whatever they had, and they're like, uh-oh.
So basically what you're saying is they look at an origin story out of a long dormant a franchise, like with Rings, and they go, oh, this is pretty close to what we were thinking about doing. Never mind, pull the plug. Can it completely? Chef? Right.
Well, I mean, I just for shits and giggles watched Texas Chainsaw Massacre, Leatherface, The Beginning, done by the same producers and Platinum Dunes. What a honking piece of crap.
Yeah.
Shit show that is. And it's like, once again, the origin of Leatherface done horribly wrong. Everything about it is a big, giant, steaming piece of shit, except for some of the special effects. Those were cool. You know, gore is always good, and everybody who does gore effects usually has a lot of respect for the material, even if they're involved in a shitty film like that. This has all the makings of what would have been a shitty piece of shit.
Yeah. Like,
I'll try to not swear anymore. Try to use big words. What a fucking horrible piece of garbage.
Save for us all, Schnapp.
Having gone off on it last week and saying my true feelings about it, I was so relieved to hear that they pulled the plug on this. I get it. I'm disappointed, too. But I'm way happier to not have a giant, stupid mistake come out on Friday the 13th of this year. I'd rather, like, hey, give it to somebody who understands how to make horror films, because obviously Platinum Dunes is failing on multiple fronts. They just have a bunch of producers who don't know horror and don't know how to handle story, and you put that together, and they have repeatedly done bad films.
And that's what they do. They did that with the Nightmare on Elm Street remake. They tried to explain Freddy doing what he did in a way that, like, started to go very wrong in the origin of Freddy being a, I don't even want to say it on air because it's that thing, but how do you not get the concept of a ghost story in the way that you hear escaped mental patient escapes on Halloween?
Right.
You get the movie, right? That's Halloween. Kid drowns while the counselors are having sex, and then counselors are killed. You get that. And that's all you need to do. So your point in Platinum Dunes, take it away from them.
Yeah.
I'm excited that it could go back to New Line.
So, if I may, let's on Twitter, Dakota Strack asks, how would you feel about James Wan directing Friday the 13th for New Line? And we know James Wan has a great relationship with New Line and WB. That's where his company, Atomic Monster, is set up.
Right.
I mean, look, sign me up for literally anything that James Wan does. Yeah. I'm on board. But I don't know. What do you guys think about that?
I want him to do other stuff. If he can hand off Friday the 13th to, what's the guy who did Lights Out and he's doing Annabelle
Sandberg.
Too?
Oh, Sandberg.
Get Sandberg on that. Like, get a good director who's coming up, who, like, I'd like to see James Wan continue to do original ideas. That's how I feel about it. I mean, Friday the 13th, we've talked about this till we're blue in the face.
Yep.
It's not rocket science. No, it's not a found footage film, you retards, you morons. Just get out of the business, or, like, get your golden parachute because you suck, at least as far as horror films. Every film I've seen in the last, like, 5 years that came out of Platinum Dunes has been an embarrassment and boring and done wrong.
I think it's important for the audience to know that Platinum Dunes has the rights to currently Friday the 13th, Texas Chainsaw Massacre, and A Nightmare on Elm Street. That is three.
And the Birds, I hear, too.
Birds.
And they've been trying to ruin the Birds for years now.
Why don't they talk to that guy from Birdemic? That's kind of up your alley. That's kind of the films you make.
The bigger thing here, too, is are they not aware of the landscape anymore? Look at the wonderful horror movies that are out there. Okay, just look at all the things that are hitting box office gold with Fede Alvarez's Don't Breathe, Sandberg's Lights Out, James Wan's Conjuring.
He'd be another great person to helm this.
Fede would be my absolute number one pick for this.
But you got to pull it out of the thing we were talking about before we started the show is, like, you had said something. I was like, you know what? It's all about the money. Because the producers of this material, they don't care about the story. It's very obvious. Like, if you've read the most recent draft, you might want to comment on, you know, if you've read the most recent draft of any of these films, you'll see that it's like, it doesn't matter. They're like, well, tell the origin. When most fans are constantly telling you, don't tell us the origin, because that kind of ruins it. Look at the films that have already done that didn't do well.
Exactly.
By just example and by, but they don't follow that. They follow, like, well, money.
Well, speaking of money, they're also making really silly decisions in that department, because look at films like stuff that Blumhouse is making, Lights Out, great movies that did not cost very much to make. I don't remember if it's Variety or Hollywood Reporter, but they said that the budget for this movie, I believe they have 21, maybe 21 million.
Too much.
If that's their price range, I think they should be rethinking. Like,
no, that's the producers pocketing a lot of money because they're shooting outside in a forest on a camp, which costs $3.
And exactly. Yeah. And you know what? On top of that, if they were spending if they were spending half of that budget, $21 million on practical effects, saying, you know what? We're going to get Tom Savini, or we're going to get the old school best in the business practical effects. We're going to come up with eight new iconic kills, then okay, I want to see a higher budget, but that's not what they're doing.
This is another reason why they have cold feet. Rings cost $25 million. That's why that $13 million opening weekend is a terrible number, because they spent, I don't know, having watched that movie, and I don't think the movie is the worst of the worst by any means. It's not good. I did not like it, but it is not the worst thing I've ever seen. I most certainly do not look at that movie and said, oh, they spent $25 million on it. it looks like a lot less than that. So I don't know what they did with that budget.
Can I, let me just add one final thing. It's a joke and an embarrassment. If I worked at Platinum Dunes, I'd be like, how do I get out of this company? Because it's so embarrassing that you can't remake Friday the 13th. It was made for like gum and a pack of like sticks. It cost nothing. It was shot out in the woods. Come on, man. It's like remaking. You just use the original script.
You could. Or just,
Start. Well, it's moronic.
We talked about, we were talking about this last night when we were at the XX screening. But, there's a twist in Friday the 13th.
One of the greatest.
I guarantee a majority of the people who would show up to a movie like Friday the 13th to see it would not know.
Right, they weren't born yet.
Exactly, that's exactly right. It really is almost as simple as taking the original script, just remake it.
Yeah.
Just remake it.
Yeah.
Like, what's the big deal? And you would have a huge reveal that a new generation would go, oh shit, what?
Yeah. And if you think about that original movie, how wonderful was that twist? You didn't see it coming.
Not at all.
You hear the legend of Jason drowning, and then all you see is an arm clad in flannel or boots. So you're like, oh, it's Jason. Wait, Jason's back.
Put the spoilers up, Cody, because I don't know if people saw this film from 30-some-odd fucking years ago.
Yeah, yeah.
Go ahead and tell them what
happened.
Oh,
okay. I'll finish. So you see this menacing whoever, boots, arm. It's Jason. You think it's Jason. They slowly go through the camp counselors, killing every single one of them in horrific original ways, right? And then, boom, reveal it's mom. Oh, my God. I didn't see that coming. What an amazing whodunit of a movie for a slasher movie with the creepy music. And then not only that, that movie serves as the origin story of Friday the 13th Part 2. Mm-hmm. Because then Jason watches his mother be murdered, decapitated, and he goes, you know what? Too much. Now I'm going to go take revenge on this camp counselor, kill her, and we're off and running.
It had one of the creepiest like post-credit scenes ever where Jason comes
big
out of the water.
Absolutely.
Come on.
I love the idea of Jason being like, you know what? Too much. It's on.
That's right.
It's on right now.
You know what? You've gone too far now.
You're chopping my
mother's head off?
Right.
How dare you, sir?
All right. Well, get your pitches ready because I have a feeling this is going to be go into active development at New Line.
More than anything, we brought this up on Movie Talk the other day. What I want to see happen, I want New Line to get the rights.
Yep.
New Line is a Warner Brothers company, and then they do Friday the 13th, the Lego movie. It sounds like I'm joking. I'm actually dead serious, because when you see what they did with Lego Batman, there's some really smart things in there for hardcore fans of that franchise and ways that they could take a meta approach where it embraces the genre overall. I think there could be a lot of fun
to
be had.
What does Lego Blood look like?
Well, here's the thing.
Not R-rated. That's what it looks like.
If there can be an H.P. Lovecraft animated movie for children, there can damn well be a Lego movie of all of the iconic slashers.
I think that's
actually very clever.
I'm all for a Friday the 13th Lego movie, but I actually want to just see a real Friday the 13th movie first. That's all I'm asking.
Fair enough. All right, well, let's move on to our next topic, which is another remake or alleged remake, but we got some new news out of Mia Goth this week about the new Suspiria film, okay? So we told you about this before. David Gordon Green has been wanting to make a Suspiria movie for a million years. He is no longer directing. A bigger splash director, Luca
Guadagnino.
Thank you. is attached. and so here's what she had to say. Per Bloody Disgusting's Kaylin Corrigan, Mia Goth revealed that the movie is, quote, not really a remake at all. And the director she describes as a really tasty person, and he knows what he wants, and that the film will be visually stunning. The cast includes Dakota Johnson, Chloe Grace Moretz, Mia Goth, and Tilda Swinton. And on Twitter, I'm going to go ahead. We'll get to this one right now. Carla Marlene at I Eat Gremlin says, guys, how do you feel about the Suspiria remake? I love Argento, but I want to be excited. And I think that's a great question. I'm all for Suspiria being remade. I appreciate what Dario Argento has contributed to the horror landscape. Absolutely. And I got shit for this a couple of months ago. Someone called me a hipster for not liking Suspiria, which I was like, I can't
wait. I think you need to look up the definition of hipster.
Yeah, I was like, what? That doesn't... You, anyway, so the point is, I appreciate Suspiria. I do. It is iconic. However, the movie never quite resonated with me in its form. So I'm ready to see a creepy Tilda Swinton. I'm ready to see this cast of really talented young women who all have their feet in the genre. So guys, what about you? Am I alone here?
The packaging on this movie is insane. I mean, you don't put a remake in a better position than by putting together a director and a cast quite like this. And I'm kind of in the same boat as you. I appreciate Suspiria. I haven't watched it in quite a while, but I think it's a perfect example of something that needs to be remade at this point, because recently, I forgot why, it was probably another story, an update about the remake, but I wanted to go rewatch Suspiria. I do not own a hard copy myself. You can't really watch it digitally anywhere.
Yeah.
That, to me, is a sign that, oh, a younger generation that has no idea what Suspiria is, has no access to the film. Let's do a great remake and try again and, you know, get this idea in front of more eyes. And Luca, I hope I'm saying his name right, because he's a fantastic director. Luca Guadagnino is not the kind of person who will take a movie like Suspiria and turn it into a Friday the 13th remake. This is not going to be a horror remake. This is going to be an artful, well-told stories with deeply developed characters. And this cast is fantastic, too. I mean, we were just talking about A Cure for Wellness.
Yep.
Not allowed to talk? Am I not allowed to talk about it?
No.
I don't know. But anyway, all right. Well, hopefully this is okay. But I like Mia Goth.
Mm-hmm.
Something about her on-screen presence, there's something just very natural and captivating about it. And I'm also a big fan of Dakota Johnson, too. I'm dying to see her do more things beyond the 50 Shades franchise. So put these people together, remake something that needs a way to get to a wider audience, and I think we're in good shape with this.
Schnepp, I know you are a huge Dario Argento fan.
Yeah, and, you know, you guys are just wrong if you don't like Suspiria. It's okay to be wrong. I'm wrong on a lot of stuff, too. But you know what? Suspiria, the original, if you haven't had a chance, it's disappointing to hear that it's not available to rent. That
it's
you do have to
really
buy it.
It's really hard to find.
A lot of older horror films, you find that. So, you know, you might want to drop some dollars on it. It's available to buy as either just a regular DVD or Blu-ray. Relatively cheap. It's very much worth that. It's a great horror film. I'm happy to hear that it's not a remake, that they're going to go in a different direction. Because sometimes for me with remakes, I don't mind if they try something different. Like with Friday the 13th, because they failed so many times, it's like, just go back to the basics.
Yeah.
I just want to see a redone version in a modern way. So with this, though, I think with Suspiria, and especially the director, I mean, he did a bigger splash with Tilda Swinton. That's a great film. It's definitely a film about characters. It's about story. Suspiria, I think, is going to have those aspects to it, but I do think it's going to be a horror film. I think it's going to have a psychological horror bent to it, but with, you know, without knowing about it, I haven't read the script for it, so I'm really excited to see a new take on Suspiria. So if you love Suspiria, don't be afraid of the new version of it. You'll always have the original.
Absolutely.
Well, so what is this then? If it's not a remake, and I'm assuming it's not a sequel.
Right.
I mean, I'm just, I find the comments she made just very interesting.
It's a reboot.
So reboots, okay.
Like the overall idea of someone going to a special school and some weird, creepy shit happening at that school, that's kind of, I think they're going to go with
just
that.
Just jumping off.
Yeah.
But using the name Suspiria because of branding. So, which I get. And that's, look, when this came out, and first when the news came out that they're remaking Suspiria, I rolled my eyes and went, great, another remake. And then the team got attached, Tilda Swinton especially, I went, I'm listening. Okay. I have no really love or loyalty to the original. So for this, it's just give me something good to watch and I'm excited and I'll tune in.
Let me mention one other thing. I mean, a lot of people talk about John Carpenter's soundtracks and musical scores.
Sure.
Suspiria has Goblin.
Goblin.
And now Goblin, if you're not familiar with them, Google Goblin, check it out. I would love to see them get some other kind of a group. If they aren't going to get Goblin to redo some of the soundtrack, get someone else who can put a very cool imprint musically on the film.
Definitely. Great points all around. Okay, let's move on. Just fair warning for this segment, there is a spoiler alert because we are talking about M. Night Shyamalan, which hopefully those of you watching will know sort of what we're talking about.
Mm-hmm. Adam, you saw it, right?
We've covered everybody.
Everybody's
in the
seen
studio.
It, right? Everybody in this studio.
Yes,
here.
And Dennis is no longer in here, so okay. Good. We're good. Okay, so for you at home, for you watching, please, spoiler alert. So M. Night Shyamalan has said he's got the next film in the Unbreakable trilogy figured out. Here's what you need to know. He wants Samuel L. Jackson to return, and Jackson has expressed interest. It will explore the last 16 years of Bruce Willis's character's life, and Knight says that a new Unbreakable movie would need to be, quote, its own idea and, quote, its own movie, that it could be watched by itself. Let's talk about it, guys. We haven't had a chance to talk about it on mic yet, and here we are about a month after release. The Unbreakable franchise has some real juice in it now, thanks to Split. So it was revealed at the end of Split that this is part of the bigger Unbreakable universe. And Knight has been talking a lot about how he's got a big outline for what he wants to do. He wants these characters to sort of cross in and out of each other's paths, including the Beast, which I think is very cool. Is it too late for this? Are we on board? Are we excited for more Unbreakable?
Oh my God, I am so excited. I think we had no idea that this was coming. And I think because of the reveal, because he tells Split as an origin story for the Horde and then ties it into Unbreakable, it is not too late. Unbreakable now is back. Everybody's talking about it. I loved the fact that at the end, in my screening, I lost my mind. Everybody in the theater who knows Unbreakable lost their mind. And I had this guy sitting next to me who lost his mind and was like, oh my God. And the two girls he was with, they're like, what? And they're like, we got to go home right now and watch Unbreakable. That's what's happening right now out there. And then they start talking to me. They're like, what do you mean?
Same screening?
What's that? No. I went opening night.
Oh, so. I was sitting with Christian, and at the point where, you know, the theme song comes on, he was like sitting like dead silent the entire time. And when that comes on, he goes to me, he's like, I'm like, yes, you get it.
And it's great. And a lot of people are calling it a twist. We're all calling it a reveal. Yep. It really was a reveal. And that's what I love about this. I said it on Movie Talk yesterday. This movie, even if it didn't have David Dunn at the end, was a great movie, was another fine piece of filmmaking from M. Night, who I believe is back. And I loved it. I loved everything about it, especially James McAvoy's performance. But when you then put it in this origin story filter and go, my God, it's the second movie of a trilogy. I'm so excited for that.
What do we think about Samuel L. Jackson? I want to bring this up because he's expressed interest in coming back, which I love, but he's also attached to another superhero universe.
Right.
And I'm wondering, are we going to be able to get him to come back? Do we need for him to come back?
He's got to play Mr. Glass. And I don't think it's the same kind of universe. I mean, the M. Night universe is much more realistic, way more realistic, where it's like sort of like, you know, just like you're Unbreakable, I'm Shatter Boy or whatever, like his bones just break. I didn't love Split, so I'm like in the minority here. Like, I found it somewhat disappointing. James McAvoy was incredible. A lot of the other performances, and the girl from The Witch, I thought was incredible.
Anya Taylor-Joy.
But a lot of the other performances were flat, and I found it a bit flatly directed. And the twist ending, for me at least, was like, ugh. It just felt like tacked on. Like, to me, it was like, hey, here's this horror film, and then it didn't really add up to me. And then there's this kind of tacked on Bruce Willis at the end type of thing, which I love Unbreakable. And even with the weird like freeze frame ending, like Mr. Glass spent the rest of his year and you're reading all this stuff. Like, why did they just show that? I still love Unbreakable. So that we're getting the chance to have another Unbreakable kind of like makes me like Split a little bit more. I didn't hate it, but I just didn't love it. So
that's fair.
I loved it. I loved it quite a bit. The first time I saw Split, though, I walked out talking about Split the movie much more so than the twist. You know, obviously I got it. I've seen Unbreakable many times. The first time I had seen Split, I don't think I had watched Unbreakable in maybe like a year or two. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't really fresh in my mind. Then I watched Unbreakable again. Then I went and I saw Split again. And wow. This is how you start to build a cinematic universe when maybe it's not what was intentionally planned from day one. There's just so many things you can do with it. And what makes me okay with this is how he puts it in one of these quotes where he says, this third movie needs to have its own idea. Mm-hmm. Okay, that's how you continue on a franchise. You may do just like what he did in Split. You make a movie that can stand on its own and then has all this connective tissue to unite everything in a way that makes sense and makes everything like still have a good story, but building this bigger world all at the same time. That, and one of the coolest things about that is that way anybody, any moviegoer out there can enter at any point and then go and like what we were just talking about with Unbreakable. You can start with Split and then go back to Unbreakable, and you know what? It still has the same effect no matter which way you watch it. That's the coolest thing.
I want to try that because I haven't seen Unbreakable in years. I want to try possibly seeing Unbreakable and then Split right after it and see if I feel different. Because I did watch The Visit a couple days ago, and I actually really liked
it. It's fun.
Yeah, it's really fun and creepy. And
like a dark comedy almost. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, I think people forget that Knight is funny, and he's got a really weird, like, quirky sense of humor. And The Visit... great example of that.
No, watch Unbreakable. We went home right after Split and popped in Unbreakable, and it was just fantastic to watch. And I love the little thing that he revealed that he had the Horde, he had the Beast in an original Unbreakable script, and he got rid of it.
Oh, wow.
He was like, "This is too much." So he cut that character out, kept it in his noggin, developed it over how many years, and here we are. So I love that little nugget of info that he just he rewrote it out. From what I believe he said, I can't get the actual quote. He said it was too much. You know, we're already on David Dunn's origin and Mr. Glass. So too much. Save it for later. And that's what I love.
Great. I'm on board. I am definitely on board. All right, let's move on. So, guys, apparently The Strangers 2 is totally happening. Okay. So here's what you need to know. The Strangers came out in 2008 and made $82.4 million worldwide on a $9 million budget. The Other Side of the Door director, Johan Roberts, is attached to direct this summer. And the script was written by Brian Bertino and Ben Katai, although Bertino and producer Adrian Biddle and Unbroken Pictures are no longer involved with the sequel. And Biddle recently called the script, quote, a fantastic piece of writing. So we talked about this a couple of months ago where we were like, this is never happening. And Biddle was talking about, you know, look, we don't own the rights anymore. There was all this, you know, back and forth about the studio, who owns what, where. We've tried to get it off the ground like six times in the last couple of years. I'll believe it when I see it. Right. Now we get a press release. A press release goes out announcing that the movie is shooting this summer. It has a director, and we're totally going forward. I don't know if this is to drum up publicity, maybe drum up interest, and they're trying to secure the last bit of financing. Who knows? But, you know, by all accounts, this script that has been sitting on the shelf for the last however many years is awesome and is the follow-up that, you know, fans have been wanting. I just can't believe that this is actually allegedly happening now after like a month ago. It was like, nah, it's not happening.
You know what's cheaper to shoot than Friday the 13th?
The
some people in dirty like clothes walking around somebody's house.
Yeah.
I mean, give me a break. I mean,
isn't it a trailer park?
We had to raise $20 million in order to be able to shoot in this, you know, regular home and have some creepy people with masks walk around. That, you know, I'm glad everybody's getting paid. Let's just leave it at that.
Well, did anybody else see Other Side of the Door?
No.
Okay, I liked Other Side of the Door fine. I thought it was just fine. I would have liked to have seen it go a little deeper, a little darker, but I don't think that was the visuals. That wasn't the direction. It wasn't the acting. I thought the acting was very good. I just, you know, it set up a lot of real grown-up discussions, then it just didn't have them. It was mostly jump scares. So I would be curious to see more from this director.
I don't know. I'm just so lukewarm on The Strangers 2. If the script is great, I kind of want to give them the benefit of the doubt, but I haven't seen that movie, and looking at the rest of his resume, you know, I haven't seen any of his movies, so maybe it's not fair for me to judge based on other opinions, but most of his movies do not seem to be widely liked, so I'm not particularly thrilled about the director. I wish Bertino was coming back to direct it, so that puts another damper on it, and I don't really like this synopsis either. It sounds like any other horror movie to me, like that. That concept does not need The Strangers.
Yeah, like,
as
why
the
does
title?
It have to be The Strangers?
And I don't know.
Great
it was
point.
Just, I mean, not that that can't be a... It just seems too convenient. You know, in the first movie, they go to his childhood home. Like, that was a natural... Like, nothing happened to make them, you know, have to go and stay there. And, oh, another coincidence and the strangers show up. Just the fact that they're forced to go into the mobile home for I don't know. I just don't...
So not on board. That's fair.
Yeah. the power happened. I don't know. Something about this whole premise just doesn't feel like The Strangers to me.
That's fair. Riley?
Yeah, and this is hard for me to figure out if I want this or not. And because when the movie came out, I fell in love with it. I thought it was amazing. I thought this was one of the best horror movies in a long time, and I thought Brian Bertino was a find of the century as far as, you know, the guy was a gaffer, you know, a best boy on set, you know, dragging electrical cables, and then a year later, he's a great director. And I really wanted him for the sequel, if there was going to be a sequel. Without him involved, I'm kind of with everybody here. You're reading the synopsis, you're kind of like, okay. It does get into that premise where it's like, how many of these strangers are going to now land in different areas? But yeah. The same point, I think that's their intention. I think these strangers, we don't know who they are, and that they are like this. They are going to go from house to house. But then you say trailer park, and it seems forced to put them in a creepy environment for the sake of creepy without it making sense in the story.
That was a much better way to articulate it than what I was trying to say. Yeah. Thank you, Riley.
I could sum it up for both of you. Yawn, yeah. Bored, next. Not even interested.
Yeah, I think it's too late. I do. Yeah. I think it's way too late for this brand, because I think your average horror person now, well, maybe not horror person, but your average audience member, Strangers 2 is coming out. Huh?
Exactly.
What?
Right.
What's The Strangers?
Oh, you know? Stranger Things? No,
exactly.
No.
Yes.
The Strangers.
That's
The Strangers.
What they'll do first.
And you know, you see the masks, and it's going to be, wait, The Purge? No, not those creepy masks.
You're next? Is it your next?
No, not those creepy masks.
The other masks.
That's a great point, too. It's like we've had these wonderful, Your Next is one of my favorites, you know? That was a great, great home invasion horror movie. And so, you know, we've gotten a lot of these, so now it's like they're relying on the brand name with people going, I don't get it. So, yeah.
The indie brand name. Well, we'll see. Again, we've told you that it's happening. We've told you that it isn't happening.
That's right.
And as we've learned from Friday the 13th, who knows what the hell is true anymore? So we'll keep our eye on it, I guess. All right, let's go ahead and move into our favorite thing to scream at you.
What's in the box? Oh my God.
It's our first live What's in the Box, you guys.
Hey.
How lovely. All right, first up, Stranger Things.
Yes.
Season 2. Yeah. Super Bowl spot. Not The Strangers, number 2. Stranger Things, season 2. All right, so here's what you need to know. Season 2 will premiere at Halloween, and there are kids in Ghostbusters costumes. A giant Lovecraftian monster is depicted in the spot. Millie Bobby Brown, although you can't see her face, is shown looking towards the monster in the distance. And season 2 has been teased to be darker, bigger, and influenced by James Cameron and 80s sequels. Also, do we have the Entertainment Weekly? Yeah. Yes, we do. This is the beauty of going
Cody's
live.
Got
look
us covered.
At this. Yeah. Cody, thanks awesome. For having our back. This is the exclusive first look for Entertainment Weekly at season 2, which is very, very exciting. Okay, guys, so the first thing that I want to point out is that moving to Halloween, moving the show to Halloween, do we like this? Because I'm going to say I do not like this.
Oh, what?
For me... the July release date, there's something about this world and this atmosphere that feels so American to me.
Like summer.
It does. Yeah. It feels like summer. It feels like an adventure. It feels like E.T. It feels like 4th of July. Maybe that's just because I watched it at 4th of July. But yeah, I don't know. I love summer for this. So I'm kind of bummed that it's kind of moving to Halloween.
Well, it does take place in October. I don't know. What's the weather like in Hawkins, Indiana? Do they have
you
seasons?
You mean Atlanta, Georgia, where this was shot in my hometown?
Well, hey. You know what I mean. But maybe it will have like a fall
rainy.
Feeling.
Yeah,
the only reason I don't like this Halloween release is because I also watch AHS and Ash vs. Evil Dead, and I'm like, whoa, spread it out a little
Too
bit so I can have fun with my horror all year round, not just then, but... Oh, just give me anything. Just give me anything Stranger Things. I don't care when. I don't care what it is. I don't care what time of year, anything. I just want it all.
I love this teaser, by the way. I don't know how you guys reacted to it.
I thought the teaser was fantastic.
Yeah.
I love it coming out in Halloween. It's only a couple extra months. And you know what? Maybe Stranger Things season 3 will come out during Christmas.
Ooh.
Who knows? But like that we're getting it is enough for me. I know it's like, I want it now. But you know what? Wait a couple more months. They'll just like soak in that flavor of waiting. I think, you know, if they're going to do, it's the same creative team. So if you like Stranger Things, I feel like they've got what they want to do set up. They've got a lot of the returning cast. So for me, and then just seeing that trailer and that creepy Cthulhu type thing in the clouds, that's enough for me. I don't even want to see any more until October. We've got a lot of other things. We've got a lot of other things that we've got to be watching and reading and enjoying. We're just knowing that Stranger Things is there for us in about 10 months.
It is pretty cool that we only got a 30-second spot. And how many, you could probably count on two hands how many individual images we saw in this one spot, yet there's so much to talk about. It's like when they first announced season 2, they didn't just announce season 2, they gave us the title of every single episode. It's just, it's a marketing campaign that I think really respects its viewership.
Giving you just enough. Okay, I want to put something out there real fast. Because, you know, Noah Schnapp, the young man who played Will Byers.
I am related to him. We have Schnapp reunions.
Noah Schnapp. Yeah. So he has teased that, hey, guys, maybe I'm a demigorgon. Maybe I'm a monster. Mm-hmm. And if I'm not, correct me if I'm wrong, but in this teaser, don't we see him drawing the creature that we ultimately see in the sky.
The sky, yeah.
Isn't it Will? I thought it's Will.
Is it him drawing? I don't know if we see anybody. Do we see them drawing?
I thought.
I know that's him who opens the door at the end.
No,
that's
we saw a little sketch or something before we saw it.
Yeah, so no, Clark, that's what I took from it. I did. And
like he's having a dream of this thing.
It would make sense of all characters that he's the one who would have drawn it.
And maybe is controlling the new monster.
But that's 11 that opens the door.
It is 11 that opens the door.
But I'm talking at the end.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Yes, I
can. So we're going to go dive into this right now. Just hold on, everyone.
Well, I can totally confirm for you. I can totally confirm for you that the person that opens the door at the end is 11.
Yes.
I can confirm that
I thought it was 11 of that upside down shot with the nosebleed.
I think that is 11.
Yeah, I thought that was 11 as well. But
I
could
freeze frame in this entire damn thing.
See, that's what's fun about Stranger Things, right? Is that we get this 30-second spot. Perry, you just said it too. But I mean, now we're going. We're in a live show, everybody, and you're going in your computer to watch Stranger Things. This is what's going on. Like, there's an actual live show happening. It's like, excuse me, I'm going to go watch it.
I got to do some research. I can confirm via. That's what I was talking about.
Not the drawings.
I can confirm via a very reliable source that the person that opens the door is 11.
And that's huge.
Yeah, but you just saw her on the cover of Entertainment Weekly, so that double confirms Clark because she's got the fro.
No, and you know, it's two different hairstyles. It would confirm nothing. This one does not have a little...
Wigs.
Yeah, well, that's the thing. She was wearing wigs.
She was wearing wigs. Totally. And I mean, that Entertainment Weekly... cover I love because I'm getting some Ripley flavor out of Ellen Ripley out of 11. I see Ripley there, so of course goes back to what you were describing this as James Cameron influence, which I love. And to go back to the comment you guys said about the Halloween release, I say bah humbug to you guys. This is awesome. I love that it's coming on Halloween, just like you said, Schnepp. I think it's perfect. And I think, I mean, look, we're all going to watch this thing. Everybody at this table is going to watch it in one night. Those things are going to drop, and we are going to binge the hell out of this, as well as all the fans. And I love that Super Bowl spot dropped, and I'm seeing, like, I saw at least three of my friends who did not see Stranger Things have now binged it. I saw one status update on Facebook today. They're like, holy crap, Stranger Things! And everybody's like, what took you so long, idiot?
Yeah, where have you been? Well, just to amend what I had said earlier, no one is drawing. You don't see a child actually drawing. You see a drawing of the creature. Yeah. So I must have connected dots in my head that it was Will. So that's my theory.
But that's a great theory. Yeah, I mean, come on. That is a great theory.
I think that the idea of control or being like a, you know, being connected in somehow, maybe that's where we're going. I don't know. I'm making this up, but who knows? and I can also confirm that Halloween is on a Tuesday, and so we will all be staying up past our bedtime.
See, and that's perfect because I hate it when Halloween lands in the middle of the week because there's like it's so hard to go get dressed up and go totally. Out. So I'm just watching Stranger Things season two now.
Although I wonder if they'll actually put it out on the 27th. I'll report back. Okay, so let's move on from one Netflix thing to another. Santa Clarita Diet premiered this past Friday on Netflix here in the U.S. It stars Drew Barrymore and Timothy Oliphant. And I can, I feel like this is not a spoiler to say that season one ends on a cliffhanger. However, season two has not been officially greenlit yet. So we all watched at least the first two episodes. Perry and I finished the series. Since we've been chatty Cathy's, let's just weigh in a little real quick on what we thought. Who wants to start? Because I think we have a very mixed bag here about how we reacted.
Okay.
What end of the spectrum? Okay.
Yeah. Maybe because I'm the most lukewarm. I don't know. This is just me. I don't know how you guys feel. The first two episodes, I'm like, eh. I watched it. The first episode, I was kind of digging. I got the humor. I knew exactly what they were going for. And then the second episode, I could see her getting more and more zombie-esque. I liked the spin of the mythology in zombies. But So it landed weird with me because first I was like, oh, this is kind of a retelling of Little Shop of Horrors. You know, we got the husband, Seymour.
Interesting.
Now has to feed the plant, his wife, and, you know, loosely based. I'm not saying, you know, that's just what I got from it. With that weird humor kind of in there, the only thing they don't do is break out into song, but I haven't seen the rest of the season, so maybe they do. But yeah, then I went, okay. I think I'll stick around with this, and then I forgot about it, and I haven't gone back, and that is a true sign for me that I didn't really care, that I didn't really like it as much as maybe I wanted to, so I do want to go back, but it's like, it's funny when, like Stranger Things, obviously, to go back to that, you watch that first episode, and you're like, oh my God, this one, I'm just like, okay, so now I have to watch the second episode, okay, great, now I'm going to go to bed, so I don't know.
All right, this side of the table, who wants to go first?
I think Perry should go first.
Okay. I think I was a little more positive on it. I mean, I flew back from New York and I watched all 10 episodes on the plane, one after the next on the way back. And I guess that's a sign that I did enjoy it. I didn't love it. And I think it's probably somewhat because I'm so obsessed with Ash versus Evil Dead that does such an exceptional job with what they have for a half hour comedy. And this, I don't want to say cheap, but it does have like a lower production value feel to me. And when I'm comparing it to something like Ash, which blows everything away, that puts a little bit of a damper on it. And typically, I don't watch very many half-hour comedies. I'm surprised I found this as funny as it is. And I will suggest that if you're into it at all, up to episode one or two, you should probably watch more. One, because almost every single episode did make me laugh out loud at one point or another. And also because I like what they do with the mythology of her condition. Mm-hmm. I like the little baby steps it takes without forcing you to digest all this crazy nonsense, because it's not just about her condition. It's also about the family and the neighbors and the way they package everything together. It's kind of a nice balance of everything. It's a fun watch. I think I would recommend it if the trailer and the premise intrigued you.
All right, Chip.
All right, here we go.
Other side of the spectrum.
I would recommend you stabbing yourself in the face with a bunch of bricks.
Oh, boy.
I hated this
very,
so much.
Very strong
stabbing
feeling.
Your face with bricks.
Yeah. Dull objects so that you just
put
don't
that on
die.
A t-shirt.
Yeah, just so you can continually hurt yourself, because that's how I felt watching it. I love Timothy Oliphant. I love Drew Barrymore. They couldn't have, like, they were flop sweating through the first half hour. Like, what dialogue, what horrible dialogue and what horrible direction, at least the very first episode was for me. Every single line didn't feel right or didn't feel real. I felt like they were, like, play acting in a bad play that was shot really flatly. I could not get into it. I laughed at no time. And I was watching it with my gal Holly, and we were like, are we watching the same? What are they doing? Mm-hmm. It was literally after the first 5 minutes, we were like, What the hell is going on? It's so badly written. It's like a bad kid sketch. It's not funny. And then the directing didn't even understand, oh, if you're trying to make it funny, have them deliver it as a throwaway line or this. Nothing was even directed properly. So everyone's just saying the dialogue and even like mini asides or second. It's just a mess. So that was the first episode, and I was like, you know what? Maybe it's just the pilot and they're trying to get their legs. I always try to watch three. So I watched the second one. The second one was a little bit better, but it had all of the same problems. Nathan Fillion actually through with his role. I think some of the actors got what they were doing and got into, like, at least the kind of zany, almost slapsticky approach that Santa Clarita got. But I don't think a lot of the other actors did or either weren't directed the right way, because it just really felt like a giant mess. I love the gore. I love the scene where she was eating the guy at the end. And then I tried to watch the third one and fell asleep because I really didn't give a fuck.
Well, that's fair. I actually, I didn't love the series either. However, I finished it, and I do think the way I would explain it is it's like a horror version to me of Unbreakable Kimmy Schmidt. It's this weird, off kind of humor where if you're into that kind of thing, great, it's gonna be for you. But if it's not, and you're right, the directing and the dialogue has to be delivered in such a way that is very hard to do.
They didn't service each other. They were fighting each other.
Yeah, but I will say that I felt like it got better as it went on. And Timothy Oliphant was, to me, the all-star of this series. I thought he stole the show. I thought he was hilarious. And there were some, I noticed what you said, and I agree with you, in the first couple episodes, the way you deliver really like absurd dialogue and make it feel like it actually makes sense. As the series went on, he had a couple of those moments where I was like, okay, they're getting into that groove. They're getting into that rhythm. I thought it was a fun little watch. And like I said, it ends on a cliffhanger. So part of me was like, wait a second, where's the next episode? And there was no next episode. So, we'll see if I'll be able to sleep at night until we find out if there's a season two. Also, Drew Barrymore's hair and makeup looked amazing. She looked gorgeous. And I liked the mother-daughter relationship.
I wish I looked up her name, but I really liked the young actress who plays the daughter.
They were
cute. And the neighbor, kid, because
they
the only thing
too.
I knew him from was Vacation, the remake, and I hate that movie, but I kind of liked how he tried to make that work in that movie, and I'm glad to see him, fit so well into something.
I might try to watch 3 and 4 just to give it another shake, but because I like that actress, but once again, I felt that the relationship, the way it was written, was just like so flat and just really like, who are they talking to? Are they mother and daughter? None of that felt real. So, and the jokes, once again, how they were written were not delivered the right way and they weren't directed the right way.
Yeah,
so.
Definitely gets off to a rocky start for sure. I don't know if it will get much better for you, but
I'll let you know next week.
Yeah, let me know. Okay, so let's go ahead and move into our monster of the week. So since we will be coming to you next Wednesday, which is the day after Valentine's Day, and we all know that there is no better genre than horror to get people close and snuggly on a couch.
Perfect.
We're going to talk about our favorite horror love stories for your Valentine's Day needs. So whether that is a great love story that's going to make you cry, or a scary movie that's going to get you laid, or whether it's actually got Valentine's Day in the story, that's what we're bringing you. And I'm going to just start real fast and say, I love My Bloody Valentine 3D.
Yes.
I love it.
Right?
It is so good.
It's such a great movie. Yeah.
Unexpectedly good.
Yeah.
A lot of fun.
So much fun. And I have to say, too, as compared to the original, like it's very close to the original, but to me, so much more fun. Having a little bit of a wink at the camera, but nothing cheesy. And God, I just love it. So Friday the 13th.
Yep.
Nope.
That's what we're doing here.
Let's take that again, and we're live. My Bloody Valentine 3D gives a big thumbs up for me. How about you guys?
I'm going to go with, I had My Bloody Valentine, but I'm going to go with Sightseers by Ben Wheatley.
Ooh.
Two murderous, a couple on a murder spree. Can't get lovelier than that.
I love it.
And things go really badly for them. But
so romantic.
They go worse for the other people that are hanging out with them.
Fair enough.
Definitely check it out. It's a 2012 film. I think it's on Netflix. So.
Nice.
Guys,
you want to go first?
Well, Friday the 13th, obviously. Jason and his mother.
I saw him scrolling from you.
I mean,
Psycho, hello.
You know what's funny? That this question's great. And the first thing that popped in my head was Interview with the Vampire.
Love it.
And that is, maybe it's because I love the books. I mean, I read those books, every single one of them. And what I love about Anne Rice's writing is that once the vampire turns, there's no gender in this world. you can fall in love with another vampire because you are of the blood now. And that's what I love. And so you really do. I know I'm going to blow your mind here, Collider Nightmares. It's a romance between Louis and Lestat.
Yeah.
And I love that about the. And not only that, Neil Jordan's movie is romantic in every way, the way it's shot. Obviously, we're in New Orleans a lot. We're in France. So there's a very romantic feel to it. And then it's gory as hell. I mean, I think I told the story on Nightmares that my high school girlfriend had to walk out of the movie because it was too much blood. Huh. She was like, boy. I got to get out of here. And I'm like, okay, see ya. But no, it was it's just one of those movies that I love and adore. I hope the remake, gets that good romanticism in there. So that's my pick.
Love it. Perry?
Okay, I have a few. Surprise, surprise. I'm going to say them fast. Honeymoon. I love that movie.
Oh,
came
yeah.
out in 2014.
Oh,
Lee Janiak's feature directorial debut. I think she's been doing TV since. It stars Rose Leslie and Harry Treadaway, and they go on their honeymoon, and crazy stuff happens. So definitely check that one out. Also, The Loved Ones. I'm on a big Sean Byrne kick right now because we have Devil's Candy coming up. Mm-hmm. The Loved Ones was his first feature. It's messed up. It's really messed up, and it's wonderful. You should watch that. And then, lastly, have any of you ever seen Nina Forever?
Oh, I know what this is.
It came out last year. I had seen it at South by Southwest the year before. Another directorial debut from the Blaine brothers, actually. It is horror comedy and done so damn well. It's about a guy whose girlfriend dies in a car accident, and he's like super sad and mourning, and then he starts dating and falling for another girl at work, and everything's going great, but every time they sleep together, his dead girlfriend like emerges from won't leave them alone. She comes out of the bed and just like hangs with them. It's the weirdest premise. I'm probably not selling it well, but watch it. You will be pleasantly, in a disturbed way, surprised.
I love it. I love it. Great recommendations. I also need to give a shout out to the Valentine's Day segment in the Holidays anthology, directed by Starry Eyes writer-directors Kevin Klosch, we're going with. I've been friends with Kevin for like 3 years, and I don't know how to say his last name. I'm a bad friend. And Dennis Widmeyer. But it's a fun, weird, gory, literal Valentine's Day experience. So there you go. Happy Valentine's Day. To all my single people, let's eat candy and watch scary movies together, and I'll see you there. Okay, let's move on real fast to our Twitter questions. Tweet, 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 tweet.
That just gets better every week.
It's so great.
now that I've had my voice surgery, I can actually make it sound a little more like a bird. Okay, first up, on the topic of vampires, which inevitably came up, Malik Myers asks, what do you think it will take to remove the Twilight stigma that all vampire-related properties now face? Great question. I think vampires kind of have turned into sparkly.
Right. They shouldn't sparkle.
They should not sparkle.
They shouldn't, definitely shouldn't sparkle.
So what's it going to take? You know, we've seen on TV an active pushback. Like, for instance, I have heard Guillermo del Toro say his vampires in The Strain are parasites, and they were meant to not sparkle. Like, that was his response to this, you know, phenomenon, I suppose. But what do you guys think for the big screen?
It's going to take something so big that it just doesn't exist. There is absolutely no way in this world to wipe the slate clean of Twilight. And I don't think all of those movies are bad. There's parts that I can enjoy and I'm entertained by here and there. Definitely not my favorite franchise, but it is such a thing in pop culture that you just can't make that go away. It's part of cinematic history. And we wound up with things like The Vampire Diaries, which was also hugely, hugely successful. And I think its spin-off series, The Originals, is too. So this is just a part of the vampire genre on the big and small screen. The other kind can exist. I don't think anybody ever assesses. It's like, I don't ever hear anybody talk about The Strain, let's say, and be like, oh, they're not sparkly like Twilight.
Right.
They're just two separate things, or at least that's how I compartmentalize them at this point.
Well, you know, I've made it through my entire life so far not seeing even one of the Twilight movies, and I plan on never seeing it.
I'm with you, Schnapp.
Wow.
That's why we missed the question.
Yeah.
I'm like, how many movies in this? I think there were like
three. But here's
the
thing. It's like, you know, I'd first heard about it, and then I heard about the first movie coming out, and I was just like, you know what? I don't want to see, like, this young adult, shiny, sparkle vampire movie. I just didn't want to see it. It was a giant hit. They made all the other films, which is fine. But for myself, like, how do you reinvent the vampire? Well, it doesn't have to be a big budget anything. It just has to be a scary, well-done film, but, you know, basically going back to the original idea of a blood-sucking creature, mm-hmm. a thing that preys on human beings. It's human, but it's not. There's all the different... You can go from Bram Stoker to all the different iterations of the Dracula, Vlad mythology. You can use any kind of 30 Days of Night. You can use all kinds of vampire, the ideas of vampires, and not ever even touch the surface of Twilight. And for me, that's fine. So I just think another vampire film's on its way. It doesn't have to be a big budget version of Dracula. It just has to be scary.
Well, here's what's on its way. The THR reported today that A People's History of the Vampire Uprising, a new book, that's coming out on the shelves, was just purchased, and they're describing it as World War Z with vampires.
Wow.
I like that.
Multiple storylines, CDC, but it also has some strain in there. Mm-hmm. Apparently, it's like a virus, and then this vampire uprising takes over the world. We're going to get multiple point of views.
Well, hold on a sec. That's called The Last Man on Earth,
I am Legend. And that's exactly what I was about to say. Malik, yeah. This is how we're going to take vampires back. Somebody needs to do a good adaptation of I Am Legend. That book is fantastic.
Yeah.
It is so messed up. Read Richard Matheson's book. And let's get... I'm sorry. I love you, Will Smith, but that movie... I love you, Francis Lawrence, but
oh,
that movie...
Oh, I love that movie.
Oh, I can't even. I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
Omega Man, Charleston Heston, what's up?
Yeah,
Charleston
yeah.
Heston.
Omega Man. That's what we need is what's actually going on in that book to come to the big screen.
When I was reading this, I was reading your question. I saw this news. I was reading it. And I'm like, well, this is The Last Man. This is I Am. Okay, great, whatever. But this sounds like a big budget. Mm-hmm. To go to your point, Schnepp, I think it's the vampire genre is never going to go away. I think just give me a good story. That's all you need. You don't need to overthink it like another undead person. You just, you know, put a great story on screen and I'll watch it. So
love it. All right. And by the way, my flippant comment was not about your feelings about I Am Legend.
Well,
it is.
I'm just going to slide.
No, it's just
I like the first hour of
it was just not.
I didn't hate it.
It was just not the book.
Yeah, it wasn't the book.
When the goofy CG creature showed up at the end, that's when I checked out. But I liked all of the stuff with Will Smith and his dog and like that kind of survivalist stuff.
And the Batman versus Superman logo.
Not that much.
They knew what was happening.
It kind of is a cool touch. I've never read the book, so maybe I should. Now that I'm done with Meg, maybe I'll do that one next.
Oh, Meg. Yes.
Yeah. Meg.
We'll save it. We'll save it for the. We'll save it for the Nightmares
for the
Book
Meg
Club
news.
Because we got to wrap it up. We've gone long officially. But thank you all so much for joining us to a successful first live stream, everybody.
Hey.
Thank you so much. Thank you to the panel. Perry, go ahead and tell them your business.
I was very entertained by everybody's Lego movie adaptation suggestions. Lego porn will never happen. But some of your other ideas were really good. So thanks for live chatting those. You can catch me on Twitter and Instagram at PNemroff, of course. Collider Nightmares every Wednesday. Always check it out. Then we also have Collider Behind the Scenes, which airs every Saturday at 2 p.m. PST. You're not going to want to miss this one.
Love it. John Schnepp?
Someone please animate Lego blood. Because ever since she started talking about it, I was like, I just see like somebody's Lego head getting cut off. And like, how would it be animated? Would it be little packets of...
Can someone turn us into Legos and do that to us?
Please kill all of us Lego
yes.
style.
Ooh,
can
like
find
that.
Me on Instagram and Twitter, just at John Schnepp. And check out Heroes and Movie Talk. I'll see you guys later.
Love it. And Mr. Mark Riley.
At Riley Around on Twitter and Instagram. And check out me and Clark Wolf. We did some Schmodown action yesterday. What a great, great episode. What a great match. 6 Degrees. Big shout out to you guys. You brought your game. That was fun. I'm not going to spoil it. But please check that out. I'll be on the Schmoes No live show tonight at 7 p.m. That goes live. And then I'll see you next week on Nightmares Live.
Live.
Can't wait.
Live.
Can't wait.
Thank you guys so much for watching. Thank you for all of your support over the last week. If you enjoyed the show, if you're checking us out for the first time, if you're a longtime viewer, please tell your friends about us. Share this video. Like it. Comment. All that good stuff. And until next time, we will see you in your nightmares. Hey, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.